Okay, good morning.
As you know, the topic was given to me is some basic ideas of magnetism in materials. Materials mostly, as you are going to see, will be on solids, and I will mention as we go along how the thing is done. In some sense, as you can see from this very standard thing, the periodic table, it contains a large number of elements. Of course, the number keeps going, I think, even today. If you actually can see this, strictly speaking, every element that you can see in this periodic table is magnetic, if you bring in diamagnetism also. So any material that you consider definitely is magnetic if you bring in diamagnetism also. But in certain materials, very special materials, what happens is certain other magnetism will be more prominent. In that case, diamagnetism is not seen. So that is why if you see here, there are only three elements which are actually iron, cobalt and nickel, which are actually having Curie temperature above room temperature, or they are ferromagnetic at room temperature. All other things you can see, many of them are diamagnetic and many of them have Curie temperatures much lower than room temperature. Still, the surprising thing is that even with a small number of, I mean, essentially three elements, as you can see, most of the applications that we are using every day in this room, outside, in our daily life, left and right, whatever we are using, many things actually contain magnetic elements, or magnetism is there. So magnetism has become very indispensable, as I am going to show you, in various technologies, various applications, and it is going and growing every day. So that way, that is a very interesting thing, only with these three elements, and most of the applications are at room temperature, but still we are able to manage with these three elements. The fact is not really true, because even though there are large number of so-called non-magnetic elements, which are actually the diamagnetic kind of elements, you can get lot of choices if you can combine these three elements with other things. So you can generate a large number of compounds, materials, by combining them, and that is what is actually working in many of these devices. Another thing that you can see, in fact I have another slide which I again tells you that what are the magnetic states of various elements. You can see very few elements are the so-called paramagnetic elements. As you can see, this is in the atomic state what is shown here, and many of them are diamagnetic, and very few, actually three, ferromagnetic at room temperature. Still, we are able to get a large number of magnetic compounds, magnetic materials, and they have all kinds of interesting applications, and these applications are actually growing every day, as I am going to show you. Okay, so just let us start with a very basic classification. The classification is something like this. This you will see in any standard textbook, you will be seeing this. Broadly, they can be classified as diamagnets, as I mentioned, which actually is not really of interest as far as applications are concerned, but still that has to be considered. Then you have paramagnets, then you have ferromagnets, antiferromagnets and ferrimagnets. These three categories are called ordered magnetic materials, or they are magnetically ordered, whereas diamagnets and paramagnets are not ordered. And for most of the applications, you need ordered magnetic materials, which means that you will be mostly using ferromagnets, and to very small extent antiferromagnets, and to a very large extent ferrimagnets. So the ferrites, for example, they belong to ferrimagnetic materials, which as you know have lot of applications. So the difference is they are not ordered, these three are ordered. Of course, this list can be made longer, but that will be a very special thing. I will not go into those details. I will make it a very broad classification like this. Just to give you the idea how these things are different, you start with diamagnets. Diamagnets are essentially cases where you don't have any permanent magnetic moment. What is the meaning of permanent? It will be seen very soon. So there is no magnetic moment as it is unless you apply a magnetic field. You apply a magnetic field, you start seeing a moment. In other cases, what you see is that you apply a magnetic field, you start seeing the ordering. But in this case, diamagnets, there is no moment in the first place. You create the moment, and as long as the magnetic field is there, that will be there. Once the magnetic field is removed, the moment is also not there. So that is why I have written clearly that there is no permanent magnetic moment. And permanent magnet, this, as we are going to see, will happen in all electronic orbits. Wherever there is an electron and there is an orbit, this diamagnetic contribution will be there. Whether it is going to dominate or not is a different issue. But the diamagnetism will always be present if there is an electron, and this is not a permanent situation. The moment is a function of the magnetic field. Now coming to the paramagnets, you can see this, what is shown here with the circle is an atom. So these are different atoms, and the arrows show the magnetic moment, the total magnetic moment, and you can see that there is no ordering and they are randomly oriented like this. They are actually paramagnets, but the difference from the first case is that these are all permanent moments. Irrespective of the magnetic field that is present, they are all having a magnetic moment. In the first place, they have a magnetic moment. Only the magnetic field does is to align them depending on the magnetic field strength and the temperature. Otherwise, they have permanent magnetic moments. If these, so this becomes a building block, these paramagnets actually becomes a building block for getting the ordered materials, namely ferromagnets, antiferromagnets, and ferrimagnets. If the order is something like this, that means everything is in the same direction, then it becomes a ferromagnet. If it is up down, where these arrows actually represent the total magnetic moment. I will tell you what is total magnetic moment. Right now, let us call it as total magnetic moment. So if the ordering is like this, this is also an order. Only thing is that in the bulk scale, if you see, there you can actually see a magnetic moment, whereas in the second one, there is zero magnetic moment totally. And the ferrimagnets, what you are seeing is, essentially it is an antiferromagnetic kind of an arrangement, but what happens is you have two different kinds of atoms or different kinds of ions. Their magnetic moment, the magnitude is not the same, but they are oppositely aligned. So even though the alignment is antiferromagnetic, you will have a net magnetic moment at the end. So that is the difference between ferromagnets, antiferromagnets, and ferrimagnets. So these three come under the category of ordered magnetic materials. Before we really try to see each of these categories, we'll also talk about some of the other ways of classifying them. This is another classification. This is also important to understand magnetism in some sense. That is why I am giving you this classification also. Basically, I can classify them as metallic, like for example, iron, cobalt, or their alloys. All of them come under the category of metallic magnetic materials. Many of the permanent magnets that you see are made of such alloys. So they come under the category of metallic magnetic materials. Then you have magnetic ceramics. That means they are electrically insulating, but they are magnetic. Best example is ferrite. Ferrites are all magnetic ceramics. They are, their electrical resistivity is very, very high, whereas in the first case, it is very low. Then other this difference is very important, because in the first case, the metallic materials, the electrical resistivity is very low, and as you must be knowing, if you are actually subjecting to a cycle of magnetic field, or if you are alternating the magnetic field, you will always end up with eddy currents, as you have studied, right? So this resistivity being very small, their eddy current losses are going to be very large, whereas in the case of ceramic materials like ferrites, even though the frequency is very high, like microwaves and so on, there is no such loss as far as eddy current is concerned. So that is why any of the high frequency applications, what you see is the magnetic ceramic materials. Ferrites are very important because they don't have this problem of eddy current losses, and they are always preferred for high frequency applications. So this electrical resistivity difference is important. Then comes, from the point of view of application as well as from the point of view of fundamental physics, this classification of thin films and multilayers. Multilayers is somewhat a recent phenomenon, but thin films, of course, for many decades it is known because of the magnetic recording and so on. Magnetic thin films and multilayers are very important. These days, of course, one cannot skip this thing, that is nanostructured magnetic materials. As in the other fields, magnetism also shows a lot of change when the material is reduced in dimension from the bulk, the so-called bulk dimension, to a nanoscale dimension. You can actually see wonderful properties, sometimes good, sometimes bad, both are studied, and this is a very, very important topic of research today, the magnetism in nanomaterials. Because of various applications, this is very interesting today. Another very somewhat new topic is molecular magnets, magnetism in molecules. Again, very, very interesting. Lot of chemistry people are actually doing because of the interest that they have. So molecular magnets are very, very important today. Then comes, all these things are essentially in the solid form, but now some of you must be knowing, magnetism actually is extending to the other phase also, that is the liquids, where you have ferromagnetic suspension of ferromagnetic particles in the liquid medium, by which you can actually, by applying a magnetic field, you can change the liquid properties like viscosity and so on. There are many, many properties. I'm just giving you a flavor of that. So ferrofluids again is a very, very important topic. Of course, India has contributed a lot to this field, and it is going on today. So this is another way of classifying various magnetic materials, mainly look with respect to their application in some sense. Another way of classifying this is more with respect to the crystalline nature of that. First is the single crystals, as you must have studied, you must be knowing. Single crystals means you have a completely long range order throughout the material, which of course is not possible, and you will always have some kind of a defect. Thermodynamically, it is the only situation that is possible. But still, you can have a very good long range order throughout the material. So that becomes single crystals. But again, as you know, that size of those crystals that you can grow in the completely single crystalline form is very limited, very, very small. So practically for any application, this is almost ruled out, because you can't get sizable crystals, so, and hence one cannot really work with that. So most of the time you work with polycrystalline samples. Most of the applications that we use magnetic materials, all such materials, most of the materials are actually polycrystalline in nature, which means that you have grains and grain boundaries. Grains means you have some kind of a order, crystalline order. I'm not talking about a magnetic order here, the crystalline order over some region, and then you have some problem, and then you have other grains. So the grains and separating them, the grain boundaries, again very important thing in determining the magnetic properties. So that is other class, which actually is the easiest thing to prepare, because single crystals are extremely difficult to prepare. Polycrystalline is all right. Then comes amorphous. Amorphous, again, these days applications are coming. Of course, it was known earlier also, but this again is increasing today. Amorphous materials is extreme of the other extreme end of single crystalline. There is absolutely no long range order throughout, long range crystalline order, and this gives rise to amorphous materials. But as a single crystals, amorphous materials also are very, very difficult to prepare. In single crystal preparation, as you must be knowing, you need an extremely slow cooling so that you give enough time for the atoms to go into regular sites and settle down. So you need an extremely slow cooling rate. On the other hand, for amorphous materials, you want them to arrest in totally random sites. For that, you have to have an extremely fast cooling. So this is an extremely slow cooling, this is an extremely fast cooling. That is why something in between, that is a polycrystalline sample, this is the easiest thing to prepare. Then of course, various methods of nanostructured materials are possible. One thing is, one of the ways is to have an amorphous thing and then give an annealing. You heat it, locally the crystals will grow, and usually if you can control the size over which the crystallinity grows is of the order of nanometers, and then you have these nanocrystals embedded in an otherwise amorphous matrix. So that way amorphous and nanostructured are in some sense connected. But of course, as you know, there are other methods of preparing nanomaterials. In fact, most of the time you use other materials, but this is also one technique by which you can prepare nanostructured materials. Okay, coming to another way of classifying them, this is purely based on applications, which of course all of us are using, and this is something which is kind of everyday happening thing. So the first is the soft magnetic materials. Soft magnetic materials means this is not soft with respect to the mechanical properties, it is with respect to the magnetic properties, as I am going to show you later. This is basic, as you must be knowing, things where you need large magnetic flux, like in the case of a transformer. All such applications, what you are using is soft materials, soft magnetic materials. In fact, the core that is used in transformer is called soft iron because it is magnetically soft. So that is why, because it can actually link the flux very well, so the permeability is very high, such materials are called soft magnetic materials. Then comes the other end, that is a hard magnetic materials, where you don't have this condition, you have exactly the opposite condition, where once it is magnetized, it has to work indefinitely. That is what is nothing but your magnet, permanent magnets, the bar magnets, other things that we use every day in our labs and so on. They are basically made up of hard magnetic materials, exactly opposite of what is there in the soft case. Then comes high frequency materials. Obviously, ferrites will come as the first material here. As I mentioned, they are preferred because high frequencies, the eddy current is a problem, and hence you should take materials where the electrical resistivity is very, very high. Materials of this insulating category, ceramic category, are preferred, and they are called high frequency materials. Then you have magneto-optic materials for various magnetic reading systems. Magneto-resistive materials where the magnetic property is coupled to the electrical property, and hence by applying or changing the magnetic state, what you can do is that you can change electrical resistivity and such properties, and such materials are called magneto-resistive materials. Very important for applications because of magnetic recording is done with the help of this, magnetic reading is done with the help of this. So this is very important in terms of magnetic recording industry, magneto-resistive materials, GMR heads and other things, you must have heard about it, that is coming from this property or this particular application is being exploited there. Then comes magnetostrictive materials, where the dimensions of the material change as a function of magnetic field. You take a ferromagnetic rod, you apply a magnetic field, the length increases. That is important for various sensors and so on. Such this phenomenon is called magnetostriction. It can be a length, it can be volume, various possibilities are there. Such things are actually very important for applications, and those materials are actually called magnetostrictive materials. These magnetostrictive materials were known in the 80s. That is a very, very hot topic. And the strain, the change that happens is typically very, very small, of the order of some 10 to the power of minus 6 of the original thing. That is very small, but still it was used in many applications. Today, what you see is there are a lot of developments in this one. The conventional materials are not used. You have a lot of new materials coming. One very important discovery in this aspect today is what is known as ferromagnetic shape memory materials. I don't have time to go into those details, but I will mention here, because such materials, due to a different property, what you get, the volume change or the length change that you get when you apply the magnetic field is enormous. Compared to this one, it is enormous, and such materials are actually called ferromagnetic shape memory materials. So they are kind of, in some sense, they are able to substitute for these materials in a big way.
Really similar to piezo materials where?
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. So in fact, originally the magnetostrictive materials were thought of as substitutes for piezoelectric materials. They were actually used in transducers, basically magnetostrictive transducers, because what happens is, as I mentioned, when you apply a magnetic field, the length changes. So if you apply an alternating magnetic field, the rod, for example, vibrates, because its length increases and decreases, it vibrates. So what are you doing? You are actually applying electrical energy that you are converting to magnetic energy. This magnetic energy is producing this vibration. That means you are converting again to mechanical energy. So there are two steps of energy conversion, one from electrical to magnetic and then magnetic to mechanical. So reverse also is possible in submarines and so on, so called sonar applications, where people use these transducers to find out the presence of other things, because these waves, the way it comes, they give the correct signal by undergoing this magnetostriction in the reverse sense. So they were exactly able to replace the piezoelectric transducers. So magnetic transducers became kind of substitutes for the piezoelectric.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You were able to use the magnetic and piezoelectric material for the production of ultrasound, is there also?
Yeah.
So what ranges of frequencies are to be produced?
I don't remember the exact values right now. I have to check. Typically, I think the frequencies are generally very high.
Is it beneficial to use the magnetic material than the piezoelectric?
Okay, so that you can always argue. So, I mean, people working in piezoelectric always will tell that is better. Magnetostrictive people will tell that is better. There are certain pros and cons in both. So that way, it's where you can't tell that, okay, this is the best or the other thing is the best. That you cannot tell. There are certain advantages. For one big problem, since you are asking, I'll tell you, is that these materials, they are highly corrosive. Many of them are highly corrosive compared to piezoelectric ceramics. So what happens is, with the time, there is a problem. So this is a problem with most of magnetostrictive materials are actually metallic systems. So naturally, they will have this corrosion as a big issue. Yeah.
piezoelectric oscillator can generate wide range of frequencies and magnetostrictly oscillate.
I am not telling that that is not correct. I mean, I am not refuting that. What I am telling is, I am just giving you the possibilities of these materials where the possibilities have been already worked out. As I mentioned just now, I am not telling that piezoelectric is bad. I can't make that statement. But there are certain plus points and certain minus points with both of them. Choice depends on the kind of application, the kind of surrounding that you have, the kind of application that you are looking for. I am only telling you what are the possibilities of these materials. And these are not just taken to just show you, but they are actually used. These applications are being used. Magnetostrictive transducers are there. In fact, DRDO had a big funding for such materials, and I understand that such materials are being used, such transducers are being used in submarines.
Related to sonar, what application is magnetic?
So, basically they are put in the submarines. So, the DRDO's program was to use in submarines. Okay. Then comes magnetic refrigerant materials, which again is a very new thing. This is something which is thought of as a substitute for the conventional cooling mechanisms. I will not go to those details because all these topics by itself will take a couple, at least a few lectures to finish. Then comes, as again as you know, you have this spintronics, which is coming a big way, a replacement for the conventional electronics. Lot of things are going on, very exciting things are going on, where you are actually going to use. In the conventional electronics, you actually exploit only the charge of the electron, but in the case of spintronics, you are actually looking at the spin also. The spin also is taken into consideration, and this plays a lot of role and gives you a lot of new things, and that is becoming a very important applied as well as fundamental research area, that is the so-called spintronic materials, which actually is giving rise to what is known as half metallic systems. Identification of such half metallic systems is very important today. Then again, as some of you must be knowing, lot of magnetic materials are being considered. I can only tell considered. I don't know whether it is really there in real sense. Many materials are being considered as biomaterials and for medical applications. Some of these nanomaterials, as you must be knowing, for various treatments of cancer and tumor and other things, people are thinking. I will only tell that they are being thought of in this one because the trials are going on. I don't know what is the latest today. But generally, there is a thought for in that direction as well. Okay. Now, I will come to some of the basic physics aspects of this. If you want to get some idea, one has to understand this one. Otherwise, it becomes a very qualitative discussion. I don't want that. So, basically, the most important characterizing parameters are shown here. The atomic magnetic moment, as I showed you with the arrows in the earlier picture, they are generally designated as mu, the magnetic moment. This is an atomic property. Each atom has a magnetic moment if the certain conditions are satisfied. Then for solids, the parameters of interest are, one is the magnetization, which actually is a vector quantity. The magnetization is essentially defined as magnetic moment per unit volume. You have many atoms, you take unit volume and find out what is a magnetic moment. So that is why it is called magnetic moment per volume, it's magnetization. The susceptibility, various kinds of susceptibility one can define, but I give a general definition. Susceptibility is how much magnetization you can produce by applying a magnetic field. So basically it's a ratio of the response to the input. So that is what it is written as M by H. H is a magnetizing field, the field you apply. Magnetization that is produced because of the magnetic field is M. So M by H is a susceptibility. The magnetic induction is B, which is written as mu naught times H plus M. This is SI units. Fortunately or unfortunately, in magnetism, we usually stick to CGS units because of its mathematical convenience. So, in the CGS thing, I have written specifically it is H plus 4 pi M. Then, permeability is again an important quantity, which is defined as B by H. For example, a soft magnetic material I mentioned earlier, it is supposed to have a very high permeability because your B by H is should be large in such cases, and this permeability is a very important thing as far as a good soft ferromagnet is concerned. I should also mention here that the susceptibility, strictly speaking, is a property which is usually used to characterize a paramagnet, whereas permeability is something for a ferromagnet. So, susceptibility is for paramagnets essentially and permeability for ferromagnets. I will come to the details anyway. Now, if you want to understand what is magnetism due to, where is the magnetism coming from, then it is a very, very important thing. And the best way, as far as I am concerned, is to look at like this. Because if you take an atom, so what is contributing to the magnetic moment? You take an atom, that is the simplest thing that you can do. There you have electrons, protons, neutrons. What are the constituents which are actually contributing to the magnetism? Why not protons and neutrons? That's not really true. Proton has a charge. Electrons, protons and neutrons contribute to the magnetic moment. All the three particles, irrespective of whether they have charge or not, all of them have magnetic moment. Neutrons also have magnetic moment. That is why neutron diffraction is a very important technique. Of course, you need neutrons. It is possible in India only in BRC, but that is purely because neutrons have a magnetic moment. So, neutrons have a magnetic moment. Protons also have a magnetic moment. That means nucleus also has a magnetic moment under certain conditions. Under certain conditions, they will cancel each other. But otherwise, in principle, nucleus also has a magnetic moment. Electrons also have a magnetic moment. But when we tell that something is magnetic, we usually mean the magnetism that is coming from electrons. Nuclear magnetism is also important in some sense because nuclear magnetic resonance, which is basis of MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, where you are not looking at the magnetism produced by the electrons, it is by the nucleus, so essentially the proton of hydrogen. So, when you are discussing magnetic materials, we are not looking at the nuclear part. But that doesn't mean that the nuclear magnetism is not there. Nuclear magnetism is there, it's a very important valid issue. But in our case, it is not going to be significant as I am going to show you the reason. So, the best way to understand is to look at how an electron gets a magnetic moment. Then using that, try to find out an atom which consists of a large number of electrons generally, how different electrons are contributing to the so-called atomic magnetism. Using atoms, the first thing that I can do is to create a molecule. Like I have hydrogen, I can make hydrogen molecule. That is, so I should see how magnetism in a molecule can be explained. Then the extreme case is I put Avogadro number of atoms of that kind and it becomes a solid, and under that condition what will be the magnetism in that. So this is the sequence with which one should understand how the magnetism actually can be explained. And of course this is, as I mentioned, this is also there, but this is, I am not going to talk about today, but one has to keep this in mind because the mechanism is going to be different compared to other cases. Okay, let us take these things one by one. Electronic magnetism, the question is how does an electron get a magnetic moment? Very basic question, probably the most basic question that one can think of when we are talking about magnetic materials. As you must be knowing, electron magnetic moment essentially comes due to two reasons, only two reasons. One is the so-called orbital angular momentum, the other thing is a spin angular momentum. I don't like this concept of telling that there is a charge which is moving around and it is like a circular loop of current that is giving a magnetic moment. That idea is not really true. In a quantum mechanical sense, that is not true. So, you just attribute to the angular momentum. Yes, electron has an orbital angular momentum, it has a spin angular momentum, and both contribute to the electronic magnetic moment. How is it coming? So, it comes like this. Orbital magnetic moment, I write it, as I mentioned, mu is a magnetic moment. So, this is mu L, that is due to the orbital part. There is a minus sign here because electron E is taken as positive, the electronic charge is negative. In CGS units, this is related to the orbital angular momentum L. Similarly, I can write this S, that is a spin part. So, there is orbital part and this is a spin part with some quantum mechanics which I don't have time to explain. The total magnetic moment can be related by connecting the two with the help of this G factor, which of course you must be aware of this Landé G factor, which is defined like this. So, I can write the total magnetic moment mu as minus G times, this is called a gyromagnetic ratio E by 2mc, and this J becomes a total angular momentum. So, you can see why we are ignoring the nuclear part from these equations. You see the relation connecting the angular momentum and magnetic moment is critically dependent on this gyromagnetic ratio, where the mass of the particle is in the denominator. Neutrons and protons, the mass is something like 2000 times greater than that of the electron, and hence this gyromagnetic ratio will be very small. Doesn't mean that it is zero, but it's compared to electron, this ratio is going to be small, and hence we ignore the nuclear contribution. So, So you have only these contributions, and this gives you your J, and you must have gone through in quantum mechanics course, your J is nothing but J vector is L vector plus S vector. This is a place where you have, people generally get confused. This is a quantum mechanical addition of two vectors, L and S. This has multiple values, not a single value. So your J corresponding states that are resulting from this addition of L and S, it's multi-valued. This is J, the resulting states are designated in terms of J. The J values actually go from L plus S to L minus S. There are different values depending on the values of L and S. So you can see there are many values possible. And so this one has to keep in mind. This here it is a vector. Vector is L plus S always, but the values of this addition, the quantum numbers, J quantum numbers are from L plus S to L minus S. Of course, this is the magnitude. So I get the total magnetic moment that is coming from these two contributions, orbital and spin. So I can write the total magnetic moment in this form, and with the help of a new constant, and remember your J square, L square or S square, when you operate on these eigenfunctions, the corresponding eigenvalues are for J square, it is J into J plus 1 H bar square, as you have studied in quantum mechanics, I don't have to spend time. So that is why the J, you will get square root of J into J plus 1 H bar. So this, with the help of this substitution, which is E H bar by 2mc, which is called the Bohr magneton, which is the unit of magnetic moment, I can get an expression for the magnetic moment, the total magnetic moment as G times mu B times J into J plus 1 square root. That means if I know the J value, if I know the L value and S value, and if I know what value I am looking at, I can find out the magnetic moment provided I know G, because I can always find out G in terms of magnetic Bohr magneton. This is the magnetic moment of a single electron, just one electron. And this is a total magnetic moment, but if you want to find out the magnetic moment along a particular direction, usually the axis of quantization is taken as Z axis, you will be finding out mu Z, that will be, you have to take this projection of this along the axis of quantization, that is why I have written as J dot Z, Z cap is a unit vector along Z axis, so that will give you the corresponding quantum number, operator, the corresponding quantum number is JZ, that has a quantum number associated with this MJ, so that is why the along a particular direction, namely the Z axis, it will be G times mu B times MJ. This is the moment that is, that you can see, that you can measure by applying a magnetic field along a particular direction. So this is a total magnetic moment, this is a component of that magnetic field coming from one electron. This is what is the picture is. This is a total magnetic moment of an electron. So that I can write this one. Only thing is that is capital J, doesn't matter. So this is the moment that is coming along a particular direction, the so-called axis of quantization. And this, I will come to that later. Don't worry about this. I'm just showing the picture only. Because in quantum mechanics, as you know, these vectors cannot have any kind of orientation with respect to Z axis. Your theta cannot be continuous. Theta has to be discrete. And your relationship between the two is always discrete. And that is why this picture is shown. So theta cannot be anything.
Here, the spin magnetic moment of electron, this is the expression. So
yeah.
It is applicable to proton also, because
all these things are applicable to protons, except that your m will be the mass of the proton.
What about neutron then?
Neutron also, this is true. I mean, what you are telling is that there is no charge here. See, this expression is not coming from because of the charge. This actually is a fundamental constant. This one, I mean, the derivation of this is not very easy to do right now. So this expression, the gamma gyromagnetic ratio expression holds good. So the magnetic moment, if you calculate whether it's proton or neutron, if your angular momentum is the same, more or less same magnetic moment you have. So that problem, this the gamma factor is independent of whether it has got a charge or not, whether it is electrically neutral or not, that is not an issue. Yeah.
Sir, I think in neutron, spin magnetic moment.
Yeah, so okay, that's the only difference. Yeah. Neutron usually the magnetic moment mainly comes from the spin part. But still you will use this kind of an expression only. So this E doesn't mean that I can use this expression only when the case where there is an electrically not neutral charge, that is not an issue. This gyromagnetic ratio expression comes from a more fundamental derivation. So that way same things can be used, as he said, mostly in the case of neutrons, the contribution is from the spin. Yeah.
Your C indicates the velocity of light?
Yes, yes. In the CGS unit, you have this thing because your mu naught is not coming and C is coming always in the CGS unit's magnetism.
Okay.
Because of your relation between mu naught epsilon naught is 1 over C square. That is the thing. Okay. So, if I use the same argument for a free electron, when it is free means there is no orbital moment, there is no orbital angular momentum. So, that is 0. So, the G factor for a pure spin case is 2, and by substituting it, that is what is written here, I get the magnetic moment as this much and the component of magnetic moment as 1 Bohr magneton. A conduction electron in a metal, for example, which is completely free, if that is completely free, the magnetic moment associated with that is 1 Bohr magneton, which is the magnetic moment unit, Bohr magneton. Okay. Now, so we have some idea about the magnetism that is produced by one electron. Now, the question is, using this, how to find out what will be the contribution of the magnetism from an atom, which consists of a large number of electrons. That is why the question is here, like, how do different electrons contribute to the net magnetic moment of an atom? So, how do we do that? This, of course, little quantum mechanics is involved. I will just put it, I will upload it, but I mean, if you are not comfortable, I will not go into the details. I will only tell the basic things here. So, basically what is to be done? You want to find out how the magnetism arises in an atom. So, the best ways to find out is, you take the atom and try to see what happens when you apply a magnetic field. When you apply a magnetic field, what you, as you have studied in quantum mechanics course, you have a Hamiltonian initially. Now, you are applying a magnetic field. So, that means Hamiltonian is going to get extra terms. What is done is that is here, I will not go into all the details because that will take a lot of time. So, you have an extra term which is coming due to the applied magnetic field, but as you must be knowing, when you write down the Hamiltonian, you don't use the magnetic field or electric field, you use the corresponding potentials, because this is essentially the potentials and the kinetic energies and the kinetic energy that is coming into picture. So, the magnetic field actually is represented by the corresponding potential. What is that potential? You must have studied in electromagnetism. Electrostatic field is represented by the electrostatic scalar potential phi, right? And magnetic field is represented by its magnetic vector potential A, where the relation between B and A is B is del cross A. You must be remembering that. So, that is what is coming. This A is the vector potential associated with the magnetic field B that is applied. So, the whatever magnetic field I apply, that is represented in the Hamiltonian by this vector, the vector potential A. And then what one sees is that the momentum, again, I will not be able to go into the details, the momentum gets modified. Usually, we will be writing the kinetic energy as P square by 2m plus the usual potential energy, for example, hydrogen atom, P square by 2m plus the V naught will give you the full Hamiltonian. Now, if it is subjected to a magnetic field, the momentum changes to P plus A by C in CGS units, square divided by 2m, and potential energy remains the same. So, what happens if I expand? This is purely quantum mechanics. It needs a lot of time. I will just give you the idea. So, you expand this. What you are looking at is, because of this, what is the extra term that is coming due to this applied field? So, what you find is, you expand this, you do not consider the initial terms, the P square by 2m plus V naught term, you do not worry about it, that is anyway there. What is extra? And try to find out what is that extra term, that is what is written here in the last step here. If you see, this is one term here, the other term here. One important thing to note here is that the signs of these two terms, H naught is to be ignored because that is anyway there in the original Hamiltonian. The magnetic field effect is represented in terms which actually contain A, that means this term and this term. In this term, the sign is positive, everything is square, so it is always positive quantity. This is something which is negative, which again consists of A, that means the magnetism is affected by these two terms, the second term and the third term. Now, what are these two terms representing? That is the reason I am talking about it. So, what one can do is, I can take a magnetic field to be completely along z-axis. Then, using the definition that B is del cross A, I can write the vector potential in this form. One can do that. And then, little bit of arrangement, not very difficult actually, I will give you the slides. One identifies that you get a term LZ, that is orbital angular momentum along the Z axis, LZ component is coming here. And arranging this, I get that the extra term is, one is E square BZ square now, times X square plus Y square and minus mu b lz. So, two terms are coming and these two terms have opposite signs what does it indicate? The sign which is positive here actually is indicating the diamagnetism, as I mentioned, which is always present, and the second term is what is representing the paramagnetism that you see. So when you apply a magnetic field to an atom, you see two main contributions coming out of this, perturbing the Hamiltonian. You are actually changing the Hamiltonian because of the applied field. The applied field is represented in our equations with the help of magnetic vector potential, and using the quantum mechanics here, one sees that there are two contributions coming. These are the two contributions. If I only worry about these two magnetic field effects, these are the two contributions which are important now. So this is positive quantity that you see that it is one term, and there is another term that is here. Now, okay, this little bit of things you can ignore. So this is the same term. So what I do is, this is a general expression. Suppose I take electron spin also into account, I should write mu b l times b, I should write plus 2s, because the earlier expression doesn't consist of spin. So that is also taken into account here. And assuming that there are many electrons, because I am talking about an atom. So this is for various electrons of the atom, the summation I stands for various electrons, and I can expand, I get this kind of an expression. What is done here is, these two extra terms of the Hamiltonian will give rise to an energy shift using the perturbation approach I must have studied. So by applying these two terms, or these two terms are being treated as a perturbing terms, one can find out what is energy change. That energy change is what is written in the first order delta E1, that gives you this term and this term. As you can see, the energy change in this case is positive, in this case is negative. So now this is what is written. This term actually is, I am calling it as a diamagnetic contribution, and this is called the paramagnetic contribution given by the Curie paramagnetism. I will come to the details. Now what happens is, if I take a solid, for example, in an atom you do not talk about susceptibility. Suppose I have atom of this kind giving rise to a solid, then I can actually define a susceptibility. The definition of susceptibility is, you take the second derivative of this quantity, of course with a minus sign, this extra energy, that is nothing but a susceptibility. So this being positive, the negative second derivative will be negative, that is why the diamagnetic susceptibility is negative, whereas here it is already negative, it will give you a positive susceptibility. So positive and negative susceptibilities of paramagnetism and diamagnetism essentially comes because of the general treatment that you are doing for an atom subjected to a magnetic field. So that is what is shown here. One should, you can work it out, once I upload it, you can just work it out. So some interesting situations are, suppose all the orbits are completely filled, then what happens is, your L and S will completely be 0, the total completely filled shells, there is no orbital contribution, there is no spin contribution. So that means your one term is not going to contribute, this term will be completely gone, this is 0, and then the expectation value will be 0, you do not have to worry about it. Then you will see that you will have only diamagnetism, that is what is given by this. So all the completely filled shells, magnetism is purely from diamagnetism, because there is no contribution to paramagnetism that is possible, that is coming from this result. That does not mean that if it is not completely filled, the first term is 0. So any shell, if you have at least one electron, definitely there is a diamagnetic contribution as given by the first term. First term is never going to be 0. So diamagnetism is always there. But if the number of electrons in the the second term is not really 0, that will dominate the first one, and you will call it as the paramagnet, not the diamagnet. So even paramagnets will have some contribution coming from the diamagnetism of all the shells. That is something which is a very important point to note. Okay, so now one can actually find out the diamagnetic susceptibility, that is what is written here. As I mentioned, first the derivative with respect to field, V stands for, this is actually for the solid, because by using various atoms I can actually make a solid. Take this differential of this extra energy coming due to these terms and differentiate with respect to the field. So that, and this is per volume, that is why it is magnetization. And once again derivative will, so actually should be B, that gives you the susceptibility, which is going to be negative, as you can see here, because everything else is positive. So this gives rise to the negative susceptibility of diamagnets, as all of you must be knowing. In the same way, I can treat the, so the some of the features of diamagnetism are written here, due to essentially due to the closed shells, because other things you don't see. If you want to see, you have to look at the closed shells. Susceptibility is negative. Magnetic moments are induced by the magnetic field. Otherwise, there is no permanent moment. The atoms will not have any unpaired electrons. Generally, the susceptibility, the diamagnetic susceptibility is very, very small compared to 1. Examples are hydrogen molecule is a standard example. The susceptibility is very large since you are going to have a talk in the afternoon on superconductors. Superconductors have some connection here between magnetism and superconductivity, lot of connection. Ideally, the superconductors are the one where the susceptibility is exactly minus 1. So that is why they are called perfect diamagnets. Nothing like superconductor as far as a perfect diamagnet is concerned. Because compared to 1, very, very small values, here it is actually 1. Yeah. Yeah.
Minus 1.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so I will come to that. Anyway, it will be mentioned today in the afternoon talk. I will not be able to go into the details. So under certain conditions, you can actually get minus 1. Under the superconducting trend, in the superconducting state, what is the meaning of this? This is nothing but a Meissner effect. What is represented by this statement is a Meissner effect. Because whatever you apply, it will completely expel it. That happens only below the certain temperature. After that, superconductivity is gone. So this statement is in a purely superconducting state when the Meissner effect is possible. So this is, I am not telling that this is always minus 1. I am not making that statement. These two are independent statements. In the case of superconductors, you have the possibility of getting minus 1. I am not talking that it's minus 1 is throughout. I am not making that statement. Again, what I want to tell you is that the Meissner effect is actually a demonstration of this statement. You, whatever you apply, exactly it will be killed. If you apply 5 units, it will produce minus 5. So the ratio is minus 1. That's what I was telling. This is why the field is completely expelled by the superconductor. Okay, this actually tells you how this equation actually is valid in many situations. This one, it actually is proportional to Z and this charge and also the mean square radius. If you have larger and larger diameter radii orbits, it is going to be more. That is what is shown by this effective Z times square, the susceptibility is going to increase, the diamagnetic susceptibility. Now comes to the other term, we will take the second term. Suppose you look at the second term, unpaired electrons. So definitely if the electrons are all paired up, then there is no second term. But suppose there are unpaired electrons, then you can get that the second term also contributing to the energy change. That is what happens. In many situations it happens, like for example sodium, it happens. You have one electron unpaired in the last shell, the valence shell. But the problem is, in the atomic sense, it is fine. Sodium is fine. Sodium should be paramagnetic, going by this definition. But sodium atom is never treated as an individual thing because you talk about sodium.
No, yeah, please. The question that you started arguing about this existence of diamagnetic term and paramagnetic term,
right,
using only first order calculation. Yes. So there will be higher orders.
Yes. If I had one more lecture, I would have talked about it. There is. The second order correction can be done. Second order correction gives you another susceptibility, which is known as a Van Vleck susceptibility.
Yes.
For paramagnets. So it's a very good question. The second order correction is there. It is important in some sense, but here we are not taking because of time. Okay. So if you want to look, have non-zero second term, definitely you should have this one. But situations like sodium, when you have an outermost electron as an unpaired electron, it's not going to survive when it is actually forming a bond to make it as a solid. So atomic case sodium is fine, but sodium solid, if you take this one electron is not unpaired, it will be bonded with other electrons, sodium, and then you will not see. In that case, again you will see essentially all filled orbits. That's why sodium metal as it is will not be a good paramagnet. But fortunately, in two sets of elements in the periodic table, namely the transition metal series, where 3D, 4D and 5D. And similarly, in the case of rare earths and actinides, the 4F and 5F series, where you have unpaired electrons, the possibility of getting unpaired electrons in one of the inner shells. infused in the inner shell, even after the bond is formed, even if after the solid is formed, even after the molecule has formed, there is no problem. The unpaired electrons will remain as unpaired electrons in the inner shells. So that is what is happening. That is what is making these two series very important as far as magnetism is concerned. But this comes, if you see, this comes from the second term that we talked about in the general formalism. So the examples are, so this paramagnetism, that is why, because of this question only, I made it as Curie paramagnetism, because if you talk about paramagnetism, there are at least three varieties of paramagnetism. One is what he is asking, if you do a second order correction. There are other, there is at least another very important contribution. I will not talk about those things. That's why here what I am talking about is purely Curie. So atoms must have at least one unpaired electron. I'll come to that, what is Hund's rule. And the moments are permanent. Susceptibility is positive as you have seen, but is small. Examples are transition metal ions, lanthanide ions, as I mentioned, hydrogen atom, sodium atom, oxygen atom, oxygen molecule also. I am not writing hydrogen molecule here. You see the problem. I wrote hydrogen molecule as an example of diamagnetism, but in the same line, I am writing oxygen molecule as an example of paramagnetism. See the problem here. So this is a usual mistake that people make. People think that if I have H becomes H2, okay, it becomes completely filled and I lose paramagnetism. Oxygen also should happen. It is not. The reason is, I will show you very soon. So these are the things, some of the examples. So what happens is, I talked about Hund's rule. Let's take an atom where there are two electrons. When you have two electrons in the D shell, so I will take D electrons because that is the most important series. If I have, what is the ground state? You have to find out, because you have two electrons means each of the electrons will have L value and S value. That means I have to find out the resultant L and resultant S. That is what is found out with the help of set of rules called the Hund's rules. What is the, especially you are looking at the ground state. If you want to find out the ground state, what do you do? You take the shell. I will go to the example, that is better. I have two electrons to fill. That is a 3D2 case, two electrons in the 3D shell. There is an order in which these electrons must occupy these ML values, L equal to 2 for a D shell, and the values are 2, 1, 0, minus 1, minus 2, that you must be knowing. So if I want, there is a way in which this has to be filled. The first electron will get filled here. It will be an up spin, and the next one will come, and its color is not this one. So it is coming here as an up spin. The point is, if the first is up, the second also will be up, so that the maximum value of MS is obtained. MS is the corresponding quantum number for S, and they should not go to the lower ML values as far as possible. Only rule they have to follow is the Pauli's principle. That means two up spins should not go to the same box, two down spins also should not go to the same box, but as far as possible they should be up, and that means they have to take only one per this one and goes on. So if I have five, all five up will be there up to this. If I have sixth one, it will be one, it will be down, but that has to come to the two place. So this is the, what is known as Hund's set of rules, which actually tells you what is a ground state value for the total J, because the total J is what is going to determine the total magnetic moment. The total magnetic moment, as I told you, is determined by your J, the total angular momentum. So J has to be found out. But remember, very, very important thing that many people make this mistake. Hund's rule, when you apply, it only talks about the ground state. Ground state of an individual atom is what is given by Hund's rule. In all other cases, if you use, you have to be careful. You can make lot of mistakes. So this gives you the idea of finding out, I have written the values. So the way if you fill, I can find out my J, and for less than half fill, because half fill case is 5, here it is only 2, it is less than half fill. So the J is given by L minus S, one of the values allowed when you add an L and S. So it is L minus S, the values are given here. I can find out the magnetic moment in this case to be 4 by 3 Bohr magnetons if I have 3D2 configuration atom isolated, no other interaction. I talked about oxygen and hydrogen comparison. The mistake is, when you are trying to find out magnetism of molecules, you cannot use the normal molecule, the atomic orbitals. What one has to do is, one has to use a so-called molecular orbitals. That is what is shown here. In the case of hydrogen, the molecular orbitals, this is the bonding orbital, this is the antibonding orbital. Molecular orbital here, it can take two electrons, one up, one down, that means it is diamagnetic. So hydrogen molecule is diamagnetic. If it is an atom, only one will be there, it is paramagnetic. Whereas if I go to oxygen, things are little more complicated because I have 8 electrons. The molecular orbitals are something like this. I will not go to the details. What you see is certain degeneracies are there that will allow two up spins to be in the same thing, and you can see there is no complete cancellation, and hence oxygen molecule is paramagnetic and not diamagnetic. Now comes the most important thing. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. Okay, I'll go to hydrogen. Hydrogen, see, you have one electron. So when you are making hydrogen molecule, you have to worry about, you are actually creating molecular orbitals using atomic orbitals. So the molecular orbitals of hydrogen are like this. This is the bonding orbital of sigma, that is sigma 1s, this is the sigma star 1. So you have to accommodate two electrons. Those two electrons will be accommodated easily here, that's a ground state. Because one is up, another thing is down, that's a minimum thing. So this becomes diamagnetic. Do the same thing for oxygen. Oxygen, the construction of molecular orbitals is not very straightforward because you have more, because you have 1s, 2s, 2p, I am not showing 1s, 2s and 2p. These are the two bonding orbitals here, these are the ones here. Now if you try to, how many electrons you have? You, 1s you forget, there are 6 plus 6, there are 12 electrons to be accommodated in various things. 2 here, like that if you see. And remember, these two are pi, you can see here pi 2py and pi 2pz, they are degenerate. They have the same energy. So there I can put two up spins, no problem. Because there are, the quantum numbers are different. Pauli's principle will come into picture only if all four quantum numbers become identical, right? So I can put two up spins and two down spins, actually speaking, no problem. So I have here, and then remaining are two electrons are remaining. These two electrons, both of them can be up and it can be here. So that means I have a, all these things will cancel out, but there is something which is not getting cancelled. So it becomes paramagnetic. Now, yeah.
Can you apply for nitrogen also?
Yes, yes, very interesting. And in fact, you can actually extend to nitrogen oxide, NO is nitric oxide, right? So one can actually compare exactly same thing, use the same kind of scheme, you can find out nitrogen actually will be diamagnetic, NO is in between, it will be less paramagnetic than oxygen. Same scheme can be used.
Same concepts can be used for everyone.
Exactly same concept can be used. Any diatomic homonuclear molecule, one can use the same concept. Why I thought I will mention is molecular or magnetism is a very important thing today. So you should, I mean, this is just a basic for that.
Since we are everything we are explaining based on only hydrogen and oxygen.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what I want.
Of course, nitrogen. No, I just wanted to compare usual misconception of telling that okay, hydrogen atom is paramagnetic. When it becomes molecule, it becomes diamagnetic. That argument is not true always. Oxygen is a simple example where it is not true. Oxygen atom is paramagnetic, oxygen molecule also is equally paramagnetic. So nitrogen again varies, changes. NO, for example, is paramagnetic. Because of this, you will have unpaired electron, one of them. Okay, now let us come to more realistic thing, that is a solid state magnetism, magnetism in solids. Here again, that's very big challenge because, as I mentioned, you have essentially two kinds of materials. One is metal, other thing is insulators. Due to time constraint, I will not talk about anything on the metals. I will only talk about magnetism in insulators like ferrites that I talked about. So magnetism in insulators like ferrites. It's slightly easier to talk also because magnetism in metals is more complicated and it needs a lot of time to have some meaningful discussion. So I thought I will not be able to do this time. So what is to be worried about? As I mentioned, when you have we are trying to look at a paramagnetic solid, if you want to find out, what I am looking at is essentially not just at ground state, I want to find out what happens as a function of temperature, because we are going to slowly to see how the applications are coming and other things. So what happens is, if you are trying to find out what happens to paramagnetism of a solid, an insulating solid at non-zero temperatures, what happens is you have a ground state, whatever we defined earlier. When there is no magnetic field, it has a degenerate, they are all in terms of the J value, total J, angular momentum. So this has a degeneracy of 2J plus 1. As you must be knowing, any J value has a degeneracy of 2J plus 1. When you apply a magnetic field, all these 2J plus 1 fold degeneracy will be removed and you will end up with 2J plus 1 levels. For example, if I have 2, degeneracy is 2, I will end up with 5 levels. That is what is shown here. So depending on the value of J, you will get many more lines, many more energy levels when the magnetic field is applied. And when you are looking at 0 Kelvin, of course, the ground state only will be populated and you can ignore these things. Suppose you are applying a magnetic field and the temperature is not 0, what happens is there is a finite probability of occupancy of these levels also. So, one has to really apply a statistical mechanics and find out what will be the contribution from all these things. If everything was here, no problem. I know the Mj value of this one, I can find out what is the magnetic moment. But now, at a finite temperature, these things are all populated, and I mean, of course, with a decreasing number, one has to do a statistical mechanical treatment, and I will not go into the details. One can do that, not difficult thing, you have studied anyway. One can do that, and that gives me the magnetic moment or the magnetization as a function of temperature, or strictly speaking, the susceptibility as a function of temperature. That is what is the Curie susceptibility or the famous Curie law, which actually gives you a constant divided by T, and that constant is called the C, the Curie constant, C by T. So, what is contained in C? C is contained in this one. C is given by N, the number of molecules or the number of atoms in the volume that you are taking. Mu effective is the J into J plus 1 term divided by 3 KB. So, this is C by T. This is what is called as a Curie law or the Curie susceptibility that generally we use in any paramagnetic situation. So, Curie constant, if you know, because once you do the susceptibility versus temperature, I will get a Curie constant. The Curie constant gives you this factor, the so called effective magnetic moment. That is what I showed in the picture, the full length of this arrow represented by G times square root of J into J plus 1. Yeah.
What is the role of polarizability with this case?
What is polarizability?
Polarizability.
Which polarizability?
Linear, non-linear, electric.
No, okay. So, what you are asking is like in the case of electric field. When you apply electric field, you can actually get non-linear terms also into account, like for example in the dielectric case. But what happens is, even in the case of dielectrics, usual dielectrics, they are all linear. In certain cases, of course, you have non-linear terms. Magnetism also you can get, but remember, magnetism is a much weaker effect than the electric field effect. So, magnetism, more or less the linear terms will work. I am not telling that the other terms are not there. Your question is important. But usually in basic ideas, we do not really worry about the higher order terms. Only very, very special cases, if you are looking at very, very carefully, you will take the non-linear terms into account. Then you have a non-linear susceptibility, but usually no. Okay. Usually they are much weaker, but much weaker than the electric field. Electric field itself, you generally do not take. Most of the dielectrics are linear dielectrics.
Okay.
But the question is very important. Okay, so that gives me the Curie constant, and that from the Curie constant I can get some idea about this one. So, once you know the Curie constant, you can find out various things. This is a scheme actually which tells you how, because four of atoms are all paramagnetic. So, you can see how the experiment and theory are matching. You find out the Curie constant, and from that you can find out the effective moment. You can actually calculate the effective moment using the value of J and substituting it. You will see that there is a good match between the two as far as rare earths are concerned. They are all rare earths. The 4F elements are concerned. They are all fine. They are able to manage this very well, and the experiment and theory are, I mean, both of them are matching very well. So, this is a Curie law, C by T as I mentioned, where C is given by this. If I take Avogadro number instead of the small n, if I take Avogadro number, then it becomes the molar susceptibility. Otherwise, it becomes a volume susceptibility. You can get mass susceptibility, you can get molar susceptibility. If you take n, the Avogadro number, it becomes naturally the molar susceptibility with which many of us work. Okay. This is the thing, chi versus T is 1 by T dependence. If I take 1 by chi versus T, it is linear. Ideal paramagnets, this should go through origin as shown here, but if there is some interaction given by the Curie-Weiss interaction, there is small interaction between the individual atomic magnetic moments, then you will see that this is slightly deviated, not going through the origin. This of course is the chi T, if I take it will be something like this. So, this is Curie versus Curie-Weiss law. Curie, as I mentioned, Curie and Curie-Weiss, there is a separation. If I plot inverse, one will go through the origin, one will not go through the origin, it will have a positive intercept along the temperature axis. That is because you are taking into account a small interaction between the two. Okay, some of the values are given here just to give you an idea. Again, the values are very small compared to one. Yeah.
It's not valid at all.
One, this, as long as, I mean, I will tell the other way. As long as it is valid, I will call them as a Curie paramagnet. If it is not, again coming back to your earlier question, if I have a Van Vleck susceptibility, this will not be followed, I will get a temperature independent susceptibility. That's why I did not talk about the second order correction. Okay. So, another very important point is this one, I will straight go here. So, what is shown here again, what is shown in the picture only, the plot. If you take, these are all the rare earth ions, 4F ions. So, 4F, as I told you, there it is well inside. So, the outside effects are not very important. They will retain essentially like an atom. And if you see, what is shown here is the calculated effective magnetic moment. This is experimentally observed magnetic moment. Experimentally observed means from the Curie constant I find out, that is the last thing. And the next one is the one which is calculated by taking J, L, S, find out G value and so on, substitute and get this one. If you see in this case, there is a good match between the two, which means that the Hund's rule, which actually led to the final Curie expression, all these things are all right. That is why I get a good match between the two, because it started with Hund's rules, then we extended to Curie wise form and I got the values, I found out a Curie constant and all these things. So, if these two are matching, that means my application of Hund's rule is correct, my application of Curie law is correct, that is what is shown here. So, this is the very good agreement between the two as far as rare earth ions are concerned when they are in a paramagnetic solid. The problem comes now. A similar situation should be expected in the case of transition metal ions like 3D ions, but on the other hand, what you see here is this one, same thing. These are all the ions, transition metal ions, 3D and 4D. You can see the match is not very well. Between the two, the match is not at all good, which means that in this case, the application of Hund's rule that leads to the Curie law is not really true in reality. That is what is seen by the disagreement between the two. So, what could have gone wrong? That answer is written here, very, very important. What happens? And not only that, if you try to see, if I take original Hund's rule and if I make my L equal to 0 and proceed as if it has got only a spin part, then my calculation and my experiment will exactly match. In the case of rare earths, I have to use my J, I have to take, that means I have to take L and S, it will match with the experiment. But when it comes to transition metal ions, paramagnetic ions, if I take L to be 0, everything is fine. If I don't take that, there is a disagreement between theory and experiment which tells something. What does it tell? That is what is written, I am sure you have heard about this name. This is what is known as orbital angular momentum is quenched. What does it mean? When this atom, the transition metal atoms especially, when they are in a part, as a part of a solid, like for example, ferrite, if you take Fe2 plus or Fe3 plus, when they are surrounded by oxygen ions, positive ions, they produce an electric field, electrostatic field is produced, and this electrostatic field, I will not go into the details, will somehow kill the orbital angular momentum. Essentially, they are arrested, they are not able to have an orbital angular momentum, which means that they are left with only a spin angular momentum. That is why when you put L equal to 0, it works. If you don't put L equal to 0, it doesn't work. So, what is happening here is, in the case of transition metal ions, when they are part of a solid, especially in the solids like ferrites, the orbital angular momentum is not surviving. Then the question is, why not this happen in the case of rare earth ions? The reason is, in the case of rare earths, the so called magnetic electrons, unpaired electrons are in the 4F shell, which is well inside. So, they are not affected by the presence of oxygen or any other fellow outside. Whereas, in the case of transition metals, the 3D is much more outside. So, this 3D is more susceptible to changes that is happening in the surrounding, and hence only in the case of 3D this problem comes, whereas 4F you do not see that. In the case of 4F, because of this reason, in the case of 4F magnetism, J is called as a good quantum number. Total angular momentum is the good quantum number, whereas in the case of transition metal, the spin is a good quantum number and J is not a good quantum number, J is a bad quantum number. So, that is what you see in the comparison here. Yeah.
Is the experimental.
Yeah, this is what is obtained from the Curie constant C. You measure, you, what you measure is C.
Yes.
By finding out the susceptibility versus temperature, you measure C, you calculate C. From C, I will find out what is the effective magnetic moment.
So this highlighted part is this one is the expected from
one
the
is this is experimental.
Yes.
And this is the what is calculated,
calculated
using
value.
Your J into J plus 1.
So in this table, if I look into this Fe 3 plus almost in the middle.
Yes.
You are saying that you have L equal to 0.
Yeah.
And you are getting 5.82 and 5.92.
You are putting me in to spend more time.
Oh, no. I'm sorry. I just noticed it.
Very, very good question. Very, very good question. In fact, if you see, I have skipped a few things in between. Let me go back because of your this one. So what happens is, see, this question, this point is very, very important. Let me come to this. What happens is, if you see Fe 3 plus, you see that the agreement is very good, 5.82, 5.92, unlike other cases. What is the problem? The problem is, Fe 3 plus is a special case. Fe 3 plus, even if I take the orbital to be, into picture, it is exactly half-filled case. When it is exactly half-filled, your L is 0 anyway. So it is, when you put a Hund's rule, you take L, I am using the normal thing, but my, it is exactly 0. So L is 0, it will behave as if it has got only S, and whether you use it as L or J doesn't matter because your L is anyway 0. So L equal to 0 is a special case, so you should not look at the 3 plus, Fe 3 plus case to conclude anything. Fe 3 plus is a special case. In other cases only, the problem is more important. You have to look at the case where L is non-zero, but
yeah,
it acts as if L is zero.
Okay, but in that respect, if you take a look into the upper element, Mn3 plus,
yeah,
in that case, the results is almost like, hey, I mean, I can say that they are
very good. Same situation, Mn3
yeah,
plus.
But L is not zero there, no? It's
so
2.
That's what I'm telling you, the differences are changing.
Yes, it's 0.8.
The point is, if I put exactly L equal to 0 and J equal to S, I get a good match between the theory and experiment. In some cases, see, what when you are looking at, you have to look at the whole series. You can't just look at one. So, when you, especially if you are looking at a case where it is close to 0, you don't really know what is really happening. Okay. To find out what is really happening, you should take a case which is far away from L equal to 0.
Mm-hmm.
So, that is why I will, more importantly, I will worry about earlier ones, where you see that the J equal to S only gives you the match between experiment and theory. That is the issue. Okay. Now comes the last part. So, now we have paramagnets. We know how the paramagnets are formed, how they have the susceptibility, how they behave when they are part of a, when it is rare earth, when it is a transition metal. So, now using these atoms, paramagnetic atoms, as I mentioned, they can be building blocks, and these building blocks can be used to make magnetically ordered materials, three types, but I will take only the ferromagnets. So, that is what is here. When you tell something is ferromagnet, these are the things which you should never forget. They are the most important characterizing features. So, that is what is written. All of them are actually connected also. One is, they are supposed to have, compared to paramagnets, these people have what is known as spontaneous magnetization. Spontaneous magnetization means, even in the absence of a magnetic field, they must be able to show magnetism. That means, it is not completely disordered, random, as in the case of paramagnets, it's something else. Because that's the only way this is different compared to paramagnets. Otherwise, why should you call it with a new name? So, first thing is, they have spontaneous magnetization. Then, as you know, they have a Curie temperature below which they are ferromagnetic, above which they are paramagnetic. Then comes, they have, so the reason for this is attributed to originally as an internal field which is playing the role of an external field. Then it was more clear later, it was called a molecular field. Precisely, that is called an exchange field which is responsible for Curie temperature and spontaneous magnetization. Then comes, they are known to have what is known as exchange interaction, very, very important, purely a quantum mechanical property, which I will not be able to go into the details. Then you have anisotropy, I will talk about it. You have domains, as you must be knowing, and you have hysteresis, which again you know something about. So, these are the properties one cannot forget when you talk about ferromagnets. This, of course, is the well-known picture that showing the temperature dependence of the magnetization, where the temperature, a particular temperature at which it changes becomes almost zero, that temperature is called the Curie temperature. But remember, I told you that they are characterized by so called spontaneous magnetization. Spontaneous magnetization means in the absence of a magnetic field, they should show magnetism. Is it happening? Does it happen? It, a piece of iron doesn't attract anything, doesn't have any magnetism. But we call Fe as a ferromagnet, right? Fe is a ferromagnet, but it doesn't attract anything by itself. Unless you first bring it to a magnet, then of course it starts attracting, otherwise no. So what is the reason? Yes, there only the thing is, you have to bring in the concept of domains that I am going to show. The other important thing is magnetic anisotropy. Magnetic anisotropy, what does it mean? Oh, again, it's not very clear. What happens is if you have a single crystal of a ferromagnet, if you try to apply the magnetic field along different directions, you see that in certain, along certain directions, the magnetization is very fastly picking up. In certain directions, it is very slow. For example, here, if it is applied along one, of course, it's a single crystal. If it is applied along 100 direction, the magnetic field, I see that magnetization easily comes and has a particular path, and after a point, it saturates. It's completely constant here. Whereas if it is applied along 111 crystallographic direction, you see that it is very difficult and it actually comes something like this. It takes a lot of time, a lot of magnetic field, as if there is a hindrance by itself, within itself, which is not allowing the external magnetic field to do the job. So that is why it takes more field to get into the saturation mode, whereas in the first case it is, which means there is some property which is internally there, which actually is going to be dependent on the direction. There is a directional influence of an internal property that is coming into picture. That is what is preventing this. Otherwise, everything should have equally followed the saturation path. That is not happening. Yeah.
Perfect crystals, then I would expect that no matter which direction you...
No, no. That is precisely the point. Precisely that's the point. I have... You know optics. What happens? You have refractive index, ordinary refractive index and extraordinary. What happens? There is also a crystal. So what happens is along different directions, the properties are different. Why I am sticking to a single crystal? Because if it's a polycrystal, I can't have a unique direction of 100 or 111. So only in the case of a single crystal, I make this statement. So direction dependence can be talked about only in the case of a single crystal. So in fact, almost all the properties will show some difference with respect to the direction. That is what you are showing, seen here. So because of that reason, in this case, I will call 100 as an easy axis of magnetization, whereas 111 is called a hard axis of magnetization. What is the reason for this? Very quickly, I will give you the answer because I don't have time. So thing is, electron, a magnetic electron is part of a solid, like for example, a 3D electron, part of a solid. What you see is, the electronic cloud is something which like this, this you have seen. So you can see there is a directional dependence here. And assume that you have positive ions like oxygen ions sitting there. It's a solid, ferrite for example. What happens is certain directions, especially in single crystal, certain directions you can see that these positive ions and this, these are all negative electron clouds. They will be closer by. That means there is a strong interaction, attraction there. If you apply a magnetic field there, the magnetic field will not be very powerful to change it to align in a different direction. That's what I was telling, that there is an internal mechanism which is preventing the magnetic field from aligning the system. So that is what is happening here. If it was a sphere, if the charge density was a sphere, it would, this problem would not have been there. Precisely this happens, if I be going back to your Fe3 plus case, if you take an Fe3 plus compound, you see that there is no difference between 100 and 111. The reason is the magnetic electron, the charge cloud is spherical there. When it is spherical, this kind of a difference I cannot tell, everything will be same. So very, very important thing, if you are looking for properties like this, where you want, deliberately you want the difference between 100 and 111, never choose a material where the number of electrons is exactly half filled. Half filled always will give you a spherical charge distribution, L equal to 0. L equal to 0, as you must be knowing, SPDF configuration is S. S is spherical. So it doesn't give you any anisotropy. This is what is anisotropy. So any anisotropic behavior, if you want, for example, as I mentioned, a good permanent magnet, a good hard magnet must have large difference between these two. That means you don't look for such L equal to 0 materials for such materials, but they will be very good for soft magnets. So that's a contrast. Okay. So I told you that this oxygen in this example gives rise to this extra interaction which is purely inside, and the charge cloud, electron charge cloud interacting with the positive ions of oxygen, that is an electrostatic interaction, and that is very strong compared to any magnetic interaction that you can give from outside. So this interaction is what is giving rise to, just to give you an idea, that there is a splitting here, you can see. So if your magnetic field is showing some effect, it has to really see whether this can be overcome or not. If this, don't worry about the symbol and all, this separation between this EG and T2G, basically they are two different sets of orbitals. This, if you have a very strong electrostatic interaction, this difference will be large. So this is what actually is produced by so-called crystal field, the oxygen interacting with this electron cloud giving rise to an electrostatic interaction, that is called an electrostatic field produced by the crystal, that is why it is called a crystal field. So see the thing here. Just wanted to show you what is the effect of this one. Suppose you have this kind of a thing, and if you go from one end to the other, you see, for example, if it is Fe3 plus which has a D5, so you have this case, it is like this. If you have D6, I have to put one more. I am putting one more electron. There are two possibilities, either it can go here or it can be here. Suppose this difference is very large, the sixth electron will try to be here, but it has to be a downspin electron, which means that the total number will come down because it will cancel with one. Suppose on the other hand, if I have this separation smaller compared to the magnetic energy or the change in energy when you make one spin up as spin down, you see that this will not go here and everything will be here and you get absolutely no spin, no contribution. That means this is giving rise to a high spin, the other thing is giving rise to a low spin. This is what actually many chemistry people call it as a high spin complex, a low spin complex in many of their molecules. So that is essentially coming, even though it is a molecule, you have a crystal field kind of an interaction like the one which actually splits these two things. And the competition between magnetism and electrostatic interaction, that is what is going to determine whether it is going to be a low spin or a high spin case. This is what I asked you earlier. A ferromagnet as it is will be split into various domains like this. Within the domain, it is spontaneously magnetized. That is why we write as a first statement, the ferromagnets must have spontaneous magnetization, but they are split into various domains and different domains are randomly oriented as far as the magnetization is concerned, something like the one shown here. So bulk scale, you don't see any magnetization. So a iron piece doesn't attract anything because it actually has to reduce the energy, what is known as a magnetostatic energy, that is what is shown here. If it is a single domain like this, it is having a large magnetostatic energy. System doesn't prefer to have a large energy. It will always try to reduce energy as usual, and it gets into from a single domain system, it actually becomes a multi-domain status, and hence you don't see any spontaneous magnetization in the bulk scale. This, of course, it is dependent on various things. So I think I'll not worry about it. I don't have time. Oh, just to give you one idea. Because of this reason, usually if you take a thin film, the easy magnetization direction lies in the plane. It's easy to magnetize within the plane rather than making like this. If in a multi-layer like the one shown here, you can magnetize like that easily. But in a thin film, usually the magnetization will be this one. Magnetizing it in the other direction is difficult because that is going to be a hard axis of magnetization, whereas within the plane, it is going to be an easy axis of magnetization. So this is what I was talking earlier. When you apply a magnetic field, what happens is these domains will change their orientation, and that is what actually give rise to the initial increase. And finally, when all the domain aligned in the direction of the applied field, you see that essentially it has a single domain. That means the magnetization will no longer increase, giving rise to the saturation. This is again a very important property of ferromagnets. This, of course, is a hysteresis which all of us know. Various things. This is called the remanence. That is, after the field is reduced also, you see that the magnetization will not come to zero. Unless you apply a reverse field, what is known as a coercive field, it doesn't really come to this one. This is the case of a bulk. What happens is that, as coming to your question, when the size is reduced, you take a ferromagnet, try to reduce the size. When the size is reduced to a very, very small dimension, what is going to happen is the size has become so small, it is not able to contain two domain walls, I mean, or one domain wall or a two domains. So the size has become so small, it is not energetically favorable to support two domains, in which case the system will try to be in the single domain against our original assumption that a ferromagnet always has domains. So the size matters, and the size becomes smaller, it becomes a single domain particle favorably energy wise. So when you have this one, because of that, a very immediate consequence of this is the variation of coercivity. What happens is, when you have multiple domains, the coercivity is generally very low, as you can see. But as you reduce the particle size, you see that it is increasing, and it reaches a maximum at a particular minimum value. And if you reduce further, if you reduce the size further, what happens is it is actually almost losing its ferromagnetism, and it enters to what is known as a super paramagnetic state. I don't have time to go into. So this becomes a super paramagnetic region. So that is why it's called unstable. This is a super paramagnetic region. This is the single domain maximum coercivity region. Then this is the usual bulk region. Any questions? Yeah.
Is it possible to from the structure of the orbital, is it possible to identify which will be the hard axis and which will be the easy axis?
Not easy, because you should know what is a crystal field. You should know the symmetry.
Yes.
You should know the side symmetry.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have to find out the crystal field.
Okay.
You have to find out the Hamiltonian with respect to that. You have to diagonalize it. You have to find out eigenvalues.
Okay.
You have to see which is a ground state, which is a excited state, what is energy difference, as I showed you, right? So that only can tell you how strong the anisotropy will be. It's okay. Not very easy thing.
Okay.
Calculation wise, it's not very easy.
So just by knowing the configuration of it is not possible to identify.
We can only tell, at least to first order, we can tell L equal to 0. If it is half filled, it is very small.
It's
that
not, okay. But which will be hard axis or which will be easy axis? It's not, you have to do the full calculation.
Yes, you have to do a full calculation or do an experiment.
Okay. So in experiment, can you just tell what is the indicator
for? Experiment, what you have to do is that you have to take a single crystal and you have to apply the magnetic field along different directions as I plotted and see where it is easily saturating, that becomes easy axis.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Otherwise, one can also do a very complicated thing, what is known as a torque magnetometry. So we can actually find out, that will give you the anisotropy constant. From again, you can actually do some calculation and find out what is the easy axis and hard axis. Not very easy.
Okay. So identifying the easy axis is not easy.
Yes, yes.
Okay.